otherwise they'd quit, they'd mutiny, they'd throw you overboard. So this idea of sort of recreating a blend and starting again today is quite an interesting idea and quite an interesting concept. So we've started with Finest Caribbean, which is a blend of Barbados, Guyana, and Jamaica rums. And why those rums? Why those particular ones? Like, if you're a rum lover as well as whiskey, you'll know that each of those countries has its own individual flavor profile. So Barbados tends to make very balanced, tropical, fruity rums. Guyana tends to make much more rich, chocolatey, coffee rums. And then Jamaica has very high ester, funky style rums. So each of them individually tastes completely different. And when you're sort of blending those flavors together, which, you know, I'm sure Ollie will be able to tell you much, much more about, but you're sort of completing this flavor wheel. Like each, if you imagine that those flavors, those tropical fruity notes, chocolate, coffee, funky, high ester, banana notes, you know, adding those flavors all together, you can balance it out and make a much more rounded rum at the end. So it's a very different connotation when we talk about rum blending versus whiskey blending. We hope you enjoy it. We hope you love this little rum. It's beautiful. I enjoy a little sip of it as it is. We've been making some cocktails with it as well. We'll be sharing some recipes with you all, I'm sure. But Ollie, maybe it'd be good to talk about the blending process as well.
I just noticed someone put up that it's really dry. It is really dry. So the things to bear in mind, unlike Mitch, I'm not from a rum background. Okay. My first experience of rum was much like my first experience with whiskey. It was with my dad. I was 16 and he made me drink spirits. It went relatively well. And a couple of years later, I drank a bottle of Mount Gay and almost died. Since then, I enjoy rum. I like different styles of rum. But the thing is, I'm at heart, I'm a whiskey guy, right? So I like dry spirits. Whiskey's a dry spirit. Scotch isn't sweet. You think it is, right? Because you drink a lot of Scotch whiskey. And then you go and try something that's not Scotch whiskey, like bourbon, and you go, my God, everything is really sweet compared to what I drink day to day. So when we started this process on Finest Caribbean, which was, as Mitch said, about 2 years ago, well, 2.5 years ago, I guess, it was kind of a leap into the unknown for me. So my boss is a massive spirits fan. He drinks everything. You name it, he is drinking it, probably right now. I, on the other hand, I've been blending our whiskeys for kind of 3, 4, 5 years. We work in very small batches. We work in areas that we know very, very well in terms of flavor profile. And as Mitch said, the thing with rum is the flavor profiles are diverse. And that is putting it really mildly. So the most extremes I can think of is stuff like, even in this rum, Barbados versus Jamaican. Barbados, all the rums I tried from Barbados were essentially honeyed, sweet, soft, very drinkable. I mean, dangerous. The kind of things you could really go to town with. Jamaican rums, like, I was drinking a lot of Hamden or tasting. I don't think drinking is the right term for Hamden. You don't really drink Hamden, you more experience it. So it's a little bit like standing somewhere near a volcano as it erupts. And for me, what was really interesting is that it's about using kind of very small proportions of very potent stuff to make a big difference. So this rum has hopefully some natural sweetness that's provided by the kind of Bajan rums. It's got some richness and depth, which comes from a lot of the Guyana we use. And then it should have, hopefully, a little bit of kind of banana funky note right in the middle, which for me is rum, right? That's when I think of rum, I think of those kind of mental flavors. It takes about 5% Jamaican pot still rum to make that happen. So it's tiny. It's the equivalent of using Octomore in your blend, right? Which we have done. You need bugger all of it to make a big, big difference, to make a big, big comeback. The other difference with rum as opposed to whiskey, the whiskey market is in some ways quite open. It's a very small community of people. Like, all the distillers know each other, all the distillery companies work together, all the blenders know each other. And we have like a really established route for brokering for Kumar casks. And I will cover all of that when we talk about whiskey. With rum, it's a kind of different world. There's essentially one big brokering house who have been around for 100, 200 odd years. based in Amsterdam. And most of the distillers, although they seem to talk to each other now, there doesn't seem to be like this friendly, we'll say, because they don't have the blend as base of what they sell. You think about Scotch whiskey, the biggest selling product's Johnnie Walker Black, right? It contains more distilleries in that one blend than Diageo own, which is mental. It means they have to trade. They all trade with each other. That doesn't happen as much in rum. It's starting to happen more and more, but it doesn't happen as much in rum. So you have one big broker and you go to him and you buy stock, right? So we essentially buy bulk rum quite young. Finest Caribbean is 0 to 5 years old. Most of the components are 3 to 5 or 5 years old. And they're bringing that rum into Europe, and then we're taking that bulk rum off them and blending it in, blended in Europe and then bottled in Scotland. We bottle everything in Scotland because I'm cheap. That's why it says bottled in Scotland on the label. Very simple. We've got everything else there, so it makes sense to do it there. And the blend of this is a relatively simple blend. It's four component parts, three islands, with, as I said, about 5% Jamaican pot still, just to give you a bit of funk. Top of my head, but we don't need to do that. I can do the whole sharing screen. I'm learning Zoom. I'll get good at it eventually. You're going to see yourself for a minute. Hang on. Oh, it did work. Okay, so as you can see, 40% 3 to 5 year old Guyana, 35% 5 year old Barbados, 20% unaged Guyana, 5% 3 year old Jamaican pot still. That's our blend. It's not massively complex. It's relatively simplistic in terms of the component parts, but the whole point for doing it like this, and the whole point of blending like this, like they would have for Royal Navy rum originally, in terms of blending lots of parts, is to create layers of flavor. So I'm a Scotch whiskey drinker, and I love the fact that when you get into Scotch whiskey, you find layers. It develops on your palate, it changes. And the first time I tried Last Consignment, Blacktop Last Consignment, the first bottling we ever did for Blacktop, which is the original Navy rum, the thing that got me about that is it's layered, it changes, it develops, because you have all these component parts, and you have all of this, all these elements coming together, and it creates something that's an entire experience. For me, that's something that's particular for whiskey. We really wanted to do that in rum. We wanted to add something in rum where you could find all these component parts, and you could find an experience as you drink it. So hopefully you guys are trying something that's, as you're trying this rum now, it is dry, there is sweetness there, but it's a natural sweetness. You should get some funk, but it should also change as you drink it. There's lots of other funny details on here that Mitch, I'm sure, would love to tell you about, but we're going to move on and try some whiskey. So good.
Before we do, though, I just this is one of the things which I think is really cool, and I'm really glad that Ollie's been keen with this as well, is that typically in the rum world, there's a lot of misinformation and there's a lot of smoke and mirrors. And especially with blended rums, you know, normally it's like, oh, it's a secret blend and it comes from, you know, these distilleries that we can't tell you about somewhere in the Caribbean that we swam to and we found these barrels. And it's like, well, no, you know exactly what rums are in there. Let's tell people, let's share it. So being able to share those blend percentages, being able to show exactly what's in that recipe and how it develops over time, I think is really cool and really exciting. And a couple of people said there that, you know, like a lot of rums have so much sugar added to them and stuff. And there is, you know, there's you know, I used to work with plantation rum for years, which are quite open about sort of opening, adding bits of sugar to their rum. And, you know, I always thought they did that quite well and they were quite transparent about it. There are obviously rums which do add tons of sugar and don't and aren't transparent about it and sort of hide that away. We've decided here to do it with zero sugar added, and there is a lot of natural sweetness that comes with it. And we think especially for cocktails that works really well, because you can sort of add your own sugar levels to it. You can make it as sweet or as dry as you want to with it. So for some people who are expecting a sweeter rum, this will probably be quite a surprise, because it's very big, very bold, and it is probably more of a whiskey drinker's style rum. for a lot of people. But anyone coming from, you know, that sort of four square value world, they're probably going to love something like this as well.
We got a lot of fans.
Yeah.
We got a lot of fans of the rum.
Amazing. It would seem.
I think that we're being asked what distilleries are putting a lot of sugar in. I think that's what you're asking there, Paul and Melissa.
Or what distillery? Well, I mean, that would be too many to name. But if you're asking what distilleries are in the...
Like the Venezuela, cough, cough.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Good friends of their family.
You've got quite a few. I mean, to be fair, we've in the rum world, like, most of the rums you're ever going to try are going to have sugar added to it. You will know which rums don't have sugar added to it because they're like the vegans of the rum world. Like, they will definitely tell you no sugar, you know, before anything else, they'll tell you there's no sugar in this rum. So, but in terms of the distilleries in our rum here, the Barbados component comes from Foursquare. The Guyanese component can only come from Diamond, which is the Demerara Distillers, because there's only one distillery in Guyana. The Jamaica comes from Long Pond currently, but we're also playing around with some Hampton as well. So those are our distilleries that we use in our rum.
Yeah, it should, I mean, in terms of the information, Mitch asks a lot of questions about what information we can give. It should also be pointed out that because I don't come from this background where I'm into all the geeky details that I am for whiskey, like, I can talk to you about distillery specs all day and all night about most distilleries in Scotland. Rum distilleries, not so much. In terms of blending, that was actually quite freeing. I had no preconceptions, didn't really care about adding caramel colouring or sugar or anything else to it. As long as it tasted nice, we used it. Which is one of the components you'll see is zero, aged 0 years. And when it came in, when we got the sample of it, because the way it worked was we were blending, we were getting blends in, so pre-blended rum from Guyana, from Barbados, whatever. And then we're using those components, putting together various batches. We ended up with about, I think it's 26 batches, and then there's probably another at least four or five different blends from those batches. So God knows how many blends we actually did. One of the things that came up in that is that component, we knew it was zero. We'd never seen the color until it turned up and it was black. And now, as a whiskey drinker, I'm like, well, there's something not right here. And then I'm speaking to the supplier and he's like, no, they just add the coloring when they make it, right? So I went and did some research. We sent it for chemical analysis. It doesn't have any caramel, as in caramel colouring that we use in Scotland. Well, we don't, but companies use in Scotland. It's just got basically molasses added to it. So my understanding is for a lot of for Guyana, basically they traditionally would add molasses to wood to make the colour, whatever the colour you wanted it. So 100 years ago, you'd order your rum by color. You wouldn't order it by make or anything else. You'd say, I want it this color, and it would turn up that color. For me, what was interesting is the flavor profile is immense. It's quite bitter, it's quite big, but it's not synthetic. So when you try whiskey that's had caramel coloring added to it, it's synthetic, right? It tastes synthetic. This is not synthetic, mainly because it doesn't have any E150 in it. It's got something else very dark. And as it's rum, I choose not to ask. It's probably better not to find out what they actually do at the distilleries. It's probably safer.
I don't know if you guys can see in our window there. This is the unaged Guyana that Ollie's talking about.
So one of the things we're going to do when we come over and we get to do all this in person again is we've actually got those four components. So we've bottled each one. You'll get to try each component individually, so you can try the Barbados, the two Guyana rums side by side, the Jamaica rum as well. So you can see all those individual ingredients, those components, see what each island tastes like, and then see how that all comes together in the final blend as well. As Ollie says, sometimes transparency isn't always what you want it to be, but the point is to be transparent and to show you guys exactly what the rum world does and what it's like behind the scenes.
We got takers for the masterclass too. Ollie, well, both of you, but Ollie, how many marks did you go through before you decided on the blend?
So it didn't really work like that. It was a funny one. When we started doing the blend, so when Sikenna and I first sat down and said we were going to do it, actually all we did was we went to the bar. So if you ever come to London, come to our office. We have the best bar in London. It's the best bar because it doesn't have a till. So there's no end of the night. You just drink whatever you like. We also have a pretty extensive range of everything. And I literally opened, I think, every single bottled rum that we had that was in that kind of anywhere between 20 to 80 pounds. And we just tasted everything. And all we did is the same thing we do for almost everything we bottle. I'm always tasting other people's stuff. I spend my entire life drinking other people's stuff. If I look around my room right now, I can find lots of bottles by other people. And what we decided was what we liked and what we didn't like and where those styles came from. And then you can try and decipher from that the kind of flavors you want. The broker we work with, they don't offer, well, you can actually buy individual barrels and you can buy individual casks, which we do on the side for other projects. But for this stuff, you buy bulk, and the bulk is basically a pre-blend. Sometimes that'll be a pre-blend that is a specific mark from a specific distillery. And sometimes it's just like, this is Bayesian rum from Four Square, 3 to 5 year old column pot. So what they're doing is they're creating a consistent component part for you. It's actually genius. It's so much easier than blending individual casks, because that's painful. This is basically, this is the flavor profile you always get. Now, what that does mean is it may change. So like the flavor profile will stay the same, similar to whiskey, the flavor profile will stay the same, but the component parts to that particular blend might change. In terms of how many things we tried, we made up originally 4 blends using, I think, kind of half a dozen different components and didn't like any of them. We then, I think by the time we got to blend kind of 12, we started re-blending our blends, which was really stupid, but it seemed to make sense at the time. So what I would do is I'd say, oh, I like that, I quite like that. And so I then put them together in different ratios until I got to something that I thought was better. But then you've got to deconstruct that, which is a bit messy. Often I learn the hard way, right, by trial and error. What I learned was this is not how you blend. That's why it took two years of messing around. So in the end, the component parts are very simple, but to get there was a bit of a mammoth task. We also had the issue that I'm always essentially blending for one person, right? So my boss is my main customer. So Sikenna's my main customer. And what he's saying to me is, I want a rum that everyone's going to love, right? It's a bit like I'm trying to make a liqueur for him. I want a liqueur that everyone's going to love. Well, everyone loves sweet stuff. And then he tries it, I don't. He likes stuff like Longmore 1969 and Bowmore 1964. So that's what he wants. And yeah, but I can't make that out of rum. So it takes you probably about 2.5 years of messing around to try and make things that are almost impossible out of rum. And that's why it took so long.
Awesome, mate. We've got a question about our perfect measure stem glasses.
Okay.
There's a few people that ordered them. So they're drinking with them today too.
Oh, cool. So these are my favorite glass. I'm massively biased, basically, because I helped design them. So we used to, when you taste a lot, when you drink a lot, you need a glass that works. It's very simple. I would love to give you a better reason for making a glass, but we just got really bored of changing between different glassware to get different things. These are essentially a take on somewhere between a Capita, and then there was a glass we liked that had a slightly kind of bolder rim and a taper on the top, and it worked better for the nose. So I can use, this is the reason I like it, I can put about 1 cl in this and it works really, really well. On the nose, you can use it for nosing. And that sounds really stupid if you're a drinker. Why would I ever put 1 cl in a glass? But if you're me and you have to try like 200 samples in a day, 1 cl is quite an important number. I should be frank with you. If I'm drinking whiskey, I use a pint glass. I can fit a lot in it. So I always tend to go bigger measures when at home. But yeah, this is our perfect measure glass that we created, I think, 2 years ago. Again, it took a very long time. You have no idea how many different glasses we went through before we got here. As Mitch and Chanel, who are new to my team, are finding out, everything takes a long time.
So impatient.
We had a little mention as well. I think Don said that Jamaican rum has a rule about no sugar. That it's kind of a misquote. It's an interesting one. So Jamaica has a rule that says for taxation purposes, you can't add sugar to the rum because it will obscure the ABV and they won't be able to tax the correct amount. But they don't actually have a formalized no sugar rule for their rum. It is the style in Jamaica, though, not to add sugar to Jamaican rum. So there's so many, coming back to this rum idea, there's so many things where people say, oh, rum has no rules. Well, rum does have lots of rules, but we have to look at most of those rules come about not for the actual rum itself or someone going, this is what rum should be, but for the taxation of rum is more where those rules come into play. So all the Caribbean countries are now trying to fight for different GIs and different things as well. So I'm just taking the conversation back onto rum.
Yeah, half an hour in, we're talking about rum. I knew this is going
to
happen.
I knew rum was a bad idea to start with. Should have ended with rum. Okay, so on that, let's throw Mitch out and get on to whiskey. Unless, Mitch, you're happy to drink whiskey as well? Okay, so
thanks,
back to where I'm most comfortable. And, you know, the next whiskey up is Linkwood. So if any of you guys have that, pour a dram. If you don't, someone's done a bad job. Single Malts of Scotland is new in the States, just arrived. We've been bottling Single Malts of Scotland since 2002. Now, I should say that Sikinder started bottling Single Malts of Scotland in 2002 in that he made a bottle, it was a Tomartin 30-year-old, with a massive map on it, horrible label, that said Single Malts of Scotland. We're not great at kind of branding / marketing. I've got Chris on this call, so he will be nodding along to this. And largely our business is built out of enthusiasm. We're very enthusiastic. So we tend to do stuff and then go, yeah, that's a great idea. And later on going, that was a dumb idea. Single Malts of Scotland came around because Sikinder was buying originally miniature bottles, then big bottles. And like all collectors, things get a bit out of hand and he started buying casks of whiskey. So he bought a cask of Tomartin and he bottled it and he sold some to his friends in Germany and some to his friends in Japan. And so our export business was born. And essentially our business remained that way up until about 2015. So when I started, we were bottling kind of a dozen casks a year, nothing massive, stuff we liked, and selling it overseas under our Single Malts of Scotland name. We've kind of grown SMOS a little bit over the years. We buy quite a lot. We've always bought a lot. We sit on around 10,000 casks of Scotch whiskey, give or take. and I'll happily go into how we buy and everything if you've got questions on that. So my buying, I basically buy in a way of saying, I'll buy lots and then I'll taste everything. And whatever we like, we bottle. And then whatever we don't, we'll fix. And if we can't fix it, we'll find someone we don't like. Like a blender or someone, you take that rubbish away. Honestly, that doesn't happen very often. Most of it you try and fix. The Single Malts of Scotland range that we've just launched in the States is our single cask range. So everything that's coming in is single cask. Other bits of information on the label, when you see the label, and I'll get one up for you just so you can have a look. Get this one. You guys can't see that, can you?
Not yet.
No. And I can't seem to get out of it. It's really annoying. Apologies, bear with me. I set this all up so nicely earlier and it all went horribly wrong.
Ollie, what was the first thing you bottled?
First thing I bottled?
Was for single malts of Scotland.
It's Martin 30-year-old. The first bottling I ever did was back in 2013, and honestly, I can't remember. I think I did a Dalhousie 29-year-old because it was 1984, which is my year of birth. And at the time, I thought, that's cool, I'll do that. I'll buy everything I bottle. Stupid idea. actually, nigh on impossible.
So party at your.
Well, yeah, I mean, apart from it's impossible to. Right. Okay. Okay, so on our labels, you can see all of the information. Well, you could if it was a bit closer. But basically, we put the cask number, the vintage, the number of bottles, all the stuff that you'd expect of any independent bottling. You guys are all in the Scotch Club. I'm sure you try lots of independent bottled whiskey all the time. There's nothing particularly new or interesting on that. One thing you will notice is we don't put cask strength on our labels. We do that for a very specific reason. They're not all cask strength. Some of them are, some of them aren't. And it really comes down to what I like. Okay, so I'm afraid you all have to live by my decisions. It's my perfect world. It's one my wife tells me I think I live in all the time. So what we do is every time we get a sample, I always check it with water. I'll reduce it by 1, 2, 3, 4%, see if it tastes better. If I like it enough, then we'll bottle it. If it doesn't taste better, we don't bottle it. It's that simple. I feel that the job of any independent bottler is to essentially choose whiskey for you and choose whiskey they think is very good. I don't think it's our job to choose the best whiskey, because I don't think that exists. I think that it's our job to choose our favorite whiskeys. Now, my hope is that you'll experience some of the whiskeys we bottle, that you'll go to shows or shops, or I will, you know, go on a Zoom call and we'll pour whiskeys like this. And then after trying a few things, you go, you know what, I like the same things Ollie does, and then you'd buy our whiskies. That's essentially how I buy independent bottled whiskies, right? So I buy a lot from Adelphi. I actually buy a lot from Berry Brothers and Rudd, because Dougie's one of my best friends and / surrogate father. I buy from these people because I think they have amazing palates and they bottle really good whiskey. And my hope with what we do is by bottling, I think is good, enough people think, you know what, that's really good, I'll buy a bottle. The one that you're trying first, the Linquid, so we're not getting too far off track. This is a Diageo distillery, for those that don't know. So it's a big workhorse distillery that makes mainly whiskey for stuff like White Horse, and go into Johnny Walker and all sorts of their blends, pretty much all of their blends from memory. It's quite a fruity make. It's one of my favorite tasting notes ever, not for this specific whiskey, but for Linquid, is pineapple cider. It's a wonderful idea. I actually want to make it. And it's basically this kind of fresh, clean, quite light spirit, but very fruity. This has all been aged in refill wood, refilled hogsheads. That means that basically they'd be in American wood that was used for bourbon, then probably used for grain whiskey, then probably used for something else. And then if they didn't leak, they were used for this. When you buy casks like this, and Chanel will tell me if I'm dragging on too much, by the way, and if it's boring. When you buy casks like this, you don't actually know what they're like. So unless you're sampling every single cask that you buy, what you tend to do is you'll buy groups of 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 casks, 100 casks at a time. You'll bring them in, you'll then get samples from them. And if you're buying from some of the distillers, they give you very little information on the paperwork. It'll literally say hogshead. So unless you fly up to Scotland and go look at the cask, you don't know much about it. What we do is we select from that parcel, we'll then recask anything that we don't think is in particularly good wood, or we'll leave it if we think it can develop more. The great thing with a spirit like Linquid is it shines in refill wood, right? Because it's so light, because it's so fresh, because it's so clean. You don't need mountains of vanilla. You don't need mountains of sherry. It sits nicely as it is. I am a sucker for spirit, right? So I like new make spirit. I'm one of those weird people who would sit under a still and just drink it and be very merry. So this definitely fits into kind of my profile of drinking. And you'll probably find that across a lot of the whiskies we bottle, that there's a lot of distillate-driven bottlings. We do bottle some stuff from like First Fill Sherry and First Fill Bourbon and all those things. But on the whole, I love distillate. So this is my kind of whiskey. Any questions?
Yeah, just being asked there, how many casks a year do you try to acquire? Do you target to acquire?
I looked last year, we bought about 1,000 last year. No, that's a lie. We filled about 1,000. I don't know what we bought. I don't really have a target. It's kind of a weird, I live in a very weird world. So I was saying this to someone the other day. My boss owns a business that makes a lot of money, right? He's got lots of fingers in pies, all to do with booze, most of it to do with whiskey. And basically, every penny that everyone else makes, I spend. I live in this luxurious world where everybody sells something and then they come to me and they give me the money and I go and buy whiskey with it. It's like someone giving you an infinite fund from their dad. It's mental. The only qualification for purchasing for me is it good quality? And can I use it in the next kind of 15, 20, 30, 40 years? There's really no limit on how many we would buy if it's the right stock. And there's lots of examples of that. So if you take something like, we found a parcel of Imperial, one of my favorite makes, it's a beautiful make. The question wasn't, okay, can we afford to buy 20 casks? Can we afford to buy 50 casks? It was, how many are there? We will take everything. Because we'd rather buy as much as we can now and then keep it for 30, 40, 50 years and care for it properly. Then regret it. And I've got lots of regrets. So anyway, I hope that answers the question.
Psycho Disco Kitty over there, Bino, is asking, when you say filled, like when you say you filled the cask, what do you actually mean by that? Like, are you?
So we buy both aged stock and new make. So we buy new make. I love the picture, by the way. That's we buy new make from, probably about 10 or 12 distilleries at the moment. So that's for laying down for the future. Some of it's for blending, some of it's for single cask projects in the future. And we're doing that largely, it'll come on, I'll talk to a bit later about stuff like Port Escape, where we're laying down stock for the future for that. The great thing about buying new make is, one, it's cheaper. Two, you're putting it into your own woods, so you have a bit more control. You can follow the history of the cask a little bit closer. But the flip side is you have to wait, right? And I'm a relatively impatient individual, so it's a bit frustrating. Where do you apply for what, by the way? What do people think of the liquid? Anyone hate it? I'm always expecting someone to say, I hate it.
No, so far it's all pretty good, mate. We got lots of thumbs up.
Grand.
Which one's okay. Glenbergie?
Glenbergie, yeah. So, as I said, we buy in lots of different ways. This Glenbergie is a really good example of chance, right? So, my job largely revolves around tasting lots of makes and tasting lots of whiskey. The other side of it essentially is research and spreadsheets, lots of research. So what I'll spend a lot of time is looking at different makes and different vintages and finding out what happened at that distillery at what time to help me understand what it should taste like and the quality of it, or trying different distilleries and different makes and different vintages to find out where the quality lies for each make, basically. Although Scotch whisky is widely more consistent than it used to be, it is absolutely true that there is vintage differentiation. So it's not that the barley's better or the yeast is better or the water's better. It's simply they ran it differently in different years. Okay. Whiskey distilleries are factories. Okay, I'm going to throw that out there and wait for someone to get upset. There's not much romantic about that. They are big factories that make lots and lots of spirit. And depending on how you change how that factory runs, changes the spirit. And they will change how that runs based on necessity, so normally to do with economics, how much money they need, how much money they've got to spend, you know, blah, 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 blah. But my life is spending most of my time finding out how things change, what spirits are good. This Glenbergie was a spirit I didn't know that well. It's a Chivas malt. I knew it as something I'd had a couple of independent bottlers from G&M, I think, that were okay, they were quite nice, quite soft, quite fruity. And then I was on a call with a really good friend of mine at Chivas, Ian Logan, and he was telling me that they were discontinuing a line of, they used to do useful 50cl bottles. I don't know if you guys have ever got those. Obviously not in the States, but you might have bought them in the UK. And they're like 50cl cask strength bottles from all the distilleries that they don't release. So obviously Chivas release Aberlour and Glenlivet and whatever, and they used to have these 50cl cask strength bottles of everywhere else. And he phoned me up to tell me they were discontinuing them because he used to buy quite a lot on the side, you know, drinking whiskey. And I asked him, I said, what make are you going to miss? Which is your bottling that you'll miss? And he goes, Glenbergie. Well, as it happened, about 2 weeks later, I got a phone call from a blender whose marketing department had decided to discontinue their aged blend because aged blends were dead. Everyone's moving to non-age statement. And therefore, he had a load of aged stock of Glenbergie to sell. So without even asking for samples, I thought, well, if Ian Logan says it's good, it'll be good. So we bought everything. And it's basically just fortuitous. This was distilled in 1998. Most of it was refill or dechar rechar casks. Again, it was a bit hazy because we had them at different warehouses, so we had different records for different casks. And we found that one warehouse, so the warehouse is on the East Coast. This has absolutely nothing to do with geography. I will say that now. The strengths were lower, mainly because the wood was shite, right? The wood was just leaking. And then on the East Coast, where the wood was better, they were stored at a much nicer warehouse from a nicer company. And they had much better wood, and the alcohol strengths were like 59, 60, 63, which on this kind of age is mad. And this particular one came from the West Coast. The strength was a little bit lower, although not too bad. So 55, it is cask strength. Remember, this was bottled at cask strength. But I think you get probably a little bit more oxygen in these casks. They tend to be a bit more fruit driven. For me, it's quite a tropical dram. It's quite, you know, it's a beautifully kind of peachy peary dram, right? With that slight pineapple-y thing coming through. Again, pineapple. I love pineapple. It's because we started with rum. Anyway, Glenbergie, one of my favorite makes. It's obviously very, 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 very approachable as a whiskey. And I know there's at least one person in the group who is obsessed with this. So hopefully, Michael, you're enjoying it. Are they tasting it to the Glenbergie? They are, actually. Yeah. Yeah. This time it will definitely work. Okay. I remember tasting this with, so I used to write all the tasting notes, and then I got promoted away from that by hiring other people. It was a wonderful day. But it definitely has this kind of, I don't know, bready note. Does that make anything sense to anyone else? Brioche bread. And again, you'll see lots of zesty fruit because that's one of my things I like. Glenbergie. The reason I know these casks came from the dodgy warehouses because they start with a 9. All the good ones, all the really good wood that we've kept, right? I've kept all the other casks. I've kept all the wood from the other casks. They were really nice. They all started with 7. Basically, if it had a 9 in front of it as a cask sample, I was just basically going, yeah, the wood's going to be shot. Which it largely was, but it tends to not matter too much because the spirit's really nice, it's really fresh. Really clean.
Getting a lot of comments about how fruity it is and a little bit of herbaceousness. yeah, fruit's the main sort of upfront flavor that everyone's getting.
Yeah, as I said, I think Glenbergie, it's actually funny because I was trying for a few samples of Milton Duff the other day, and I find Milton Duff to be similar. Basically, Chivas make really fruity whiskies. Buy Chivas malts. For some reason, they're just very, very good. Milton Duff, similar. You sometimes get on Tormore, you get these really kind of intense fruity whiskies, especially on older Tormores. I don't know, something Chivas are doing that is very, very good. I like, reminds me of a nice Ben Nevis. That's actually one of my favorite comments. Ben Nevis is one of my favorite. Are we trying that tomorrow? I'll try that.
Yeah, that's tomorrow.
Ben Nevis is one of my all-time favorite distilleries. I find it a lot bigger than this. Because Glenbergie's got, it's still quite light, whereas Ben Nevis is a little bit oily and kind of fat and fruity.
All right.
Okay. Right. So we're going to get into slightly more smoky stuff, and again, slightly different buying. So basically, it's interesting. I hadn't really looked at the lineup, but the first, so the Linkwood we bought direct from a distiller, and it's part of an ongoing contract that we renew every year, and I'm always buying more of the make. The Glenbergie we actually bought from a blender, and it's something. Perfect example of how our industry is changing. So as blends become less popular, more malt becomes available to people like me, right? So as marketing departments tell, it's the great thing about being in a small company is we don't have this issue. As marketing departments tell you what to do, you then have to sell your whiskey to people like me, which is fantastic for me. Lord help me if we ever get a marketing department. And then the last one is a really kind of classic, going back to where independent bottling started. So independent bottling predates largely distillery own label bottling. There are some examples of much older distillery bottlings like the Freud and Ardbeg, particularly in America, because you guys are genius. During Prohibition, you legalized Ardbeg by saying it was medicine. Best thing I've ever heard in my life. One of why you can find, like, we opened a 1920s Ardbeg 18-year-old last year, I think it was. And the reason you can still find these bottles is because they're floating around America from Prohibition, where you guys apparently were like, yeah, it's fine, just bring it in. It's medicine. It's good for us. Ardbeg and the Freud, great idea. But outside of that, the kind of branded, the big branded names of whiskey started in the 50s and 60s. So Glenfiddich, Glenlivet, Macallan. Before that, Gordon MacPhail, Berry Brothers and Rudd, Cadenheads of Aberdeen. I state Aberdeen quite strongly there. They were actually rum, but you know, we'll let them believe they were whiskey. They were all buying off the kind of blending market and bottling a single malt before that. And what happens in these big deals is you have blenders who are trading stock or need stock from someone maybe they don't talk to. They use a broker in between. The broker sits there and he's basically trading in between all these people, and every now and again he's left with a parcel on the side, or he's got an amount of whiskey that he needs to sell for somebody, and we're the guys, we are the barnacle on the bottom of the boat that sucks up that whiskey. We're, you know, I've actually been called that by a distiller, which, by Anthony Wills, actually, Chris, just remind him of that. Barnacle on the bottom of the boat. So we're basically taking off the bottom of those parcels. And this next whiskey, so the Ardmore came from a big brokering deal. So it was part of a big sale to do with a blending project. And it was like an offshoot off the side of that was the sweetener of the deal was having some aged stock to sell to people. Now, you need to understand, it's not that blenders or distillers are trying this stock and going, it's no good, we'll sell it. That's not what's happening. This is a number on a spreadsheet. This is sitting there on a spreadsheet as, well, we don't need this X many 100,000 liters of Ardmore. We should sell it off, right? So probably before we've got there, it's probably not been tried for a dozen years, right? It was aimed for a blend sometime many years ago. That didn't happen. It's now sitting in their books and they now need to get rid of it, or it comes up as part of the deal and they sell it to people like us. So a lot of the time, the first time these casks are ever tried is when an independent bottler buys them. And essentially our job is to buy up this stock that's left over, that's not needed by the industry, and find it good homes. And I feel like independent bottling is the best opportunity to kind of extend and find all the little things about distilleries you would never find. So Ardmore is an example. Ardmore is a brand I feel pretty sorry for. It's owned by Beam Suntory, who are a fantastic company, makes some great whiskeys. They make Frey, which I love. But Ardmore always seems forgotten, right? It's the forgotten malt. It sits on Amazon at like £20 or something. Whenever you think of it being cheap. But whenever you actually try the make, it's incredibly good quality. Like it's a really good, slightly smoky Highland make. And when you get casks like this, it kind of shows what it can be or what it could be. Now, I should stress that it's another example of when you buy this stuff, you don't necessarily know what you're getting. So we bought two parcels, some from 1998 and some from 1997. Almost every cask of 1997 I've recast, because the wood was awful. Most of 1998 was lovely, but it had this kind of green, herbaceous, almost agave-esque thing going on. That smoke comes through as quite green. And for me, I love that. Some people will hate it. It's definitely one of those whiskies that will break a room. But I really enjoy that slightly more herbaceous, agave-esque style.
Well, I'm just wondering how you do your research on distilleries and on vintages and how it's changed since you first started bottling compared to sort of now.
It hasn't really. We're very fortunate. I work for a guy who opens a lot of whiskey. So I spend an awful lot of time trying old bottles. I do aim a lot around what people used to bottle. And I'm very lucky to be able to taste a lot of that stuff. I do a lot of reading. My favorite book of all time is Scotch by the Schweppes Scotch book. I don't know if you guys know that. I go grab my copy. Very old book. Absolutely useless for modern information, but fantastic for distillery company information going back. And ironically, currently right now, what I do is I wait for my wife to do it for me. She's a historian and she's researching Diageo makes at the moment. So she's currently doing a big thing on Kalila. And so is this useful to me? Handover. Diageo is paying for my research, which is amazing. But yeah, reading. I also spend a lot of time reading particular blogs. So I like people like Serge Valentine, the Malt Mate and Malt Maniacs. I'll go back and I'll read through all their tasting notes. But you get a very good idea. If you continuously read somebody, you get a very good idea of what their palate is, and then you can use that to help you judge vintages. Similarly with Dave Broom. Got a lot of time for his tasting notes, so I'll read back through his tasting notes, and then that helps me understand the make and how it developed. So all sorts of things, really, but largely drinking. Largely. I haven't said anything too controversial this time, Chanel. I'm doing okay.
No, I'm proud.
The Schweppes 1983 book, the UK Amazon, sorry.
I can't find the American one. I was trying to just find like. Oh no, that was delivered to Brooklyn. I'm still on Brooklyn Amazon. No, that's America. We can do that. Good. What's happened here? Is Andrew?
Someone's grabbed the thing.
Andrew's taken over. Is that on mixing glass? Oh yeah, that's on mixing glass. Okay.
nice whiskey.
We're getting a question about American single malts, but apparently it wasn't okay to just be sort of down the middle today. Drew is wanting
to. No, okay, fair enough.
You were doing
so well.
You were doing so well, mate.
So I had this question last week, which is going, it's just good. Possibly being asked in the same way. Being completely honest, I don't know enough about American single malt. I quite like some of the stuff from Westland. I haven't, with the caveat, we used to import them, and then the caveat, they dumped us, so fuck them. You know, it's enough to make you very angry. But outside of that, I was telling Chanel this, I went for a period of time when I was working for Whiskey Exchange as a buyer, and I was asked, this is quite a way back, probably 2012, and American whiskey, not single malt, just stress that, American whiskey was kind of growing in the UK in terms of interest. People suddenly were going, we have to get American whiskey in. And we're like, well, we get all the bourbons in. No, you need American whiskey, all the small niche stuff. So we asked some friends for some advice, and they sent us these samples. And I'm going to be completely frank with you, most of it was dog awful. You guys have an awful lot of distilleries. I'm sure some of them doing amazing stuff. There's too many of them, and some of them are not great. That's also true in England, but we have a lot less of them and a lot less space. So it's easier for us. So I don't know enough. There's some that I like, not many that I know well enough to say whether I have a particularly good opinion or not.
When it comes to, you did all right on that one too. Very diplomatic compared to last week.
And now I'm trying.
back on the Ardmore, how much older do you think you could have gone with this Ardmore? Do you think 21's about?
I think for this cask, we bottled it because we thought it was right now. It was still fresh and it was still clean, but it had a lot of body. We did keep, so I've still got something like 100 casks of Ardmore 1998. Sitting around in warehouses, and we will keep those. Some of them will go easily 30 and possibly higher given the ABVs. It just, part of the job is managing the stock. So it doesn't sound very sexy when you say that. It doesn't sound half as fun as it is. It's basically trying to see into the future. I should stress at this point that there is no crystal ball and we largely get it wrong. Like the amount of times you say, oh, we should keep this for another 5 years. You go back, try it 3 years later, and go, we need to bottle it now. We need to bottle it right now. Or there are certainly cases where we've kept stuff and we probably shouldn't have done. And then there's cases where we bottled stuff, and after you bottled it, you go and taste it like, maybe it would have been better. Live and learn.
Just asking about Pete and age, what do you say to the logic that peat fades away in older years? Can a peated scotch still be great into the 20 years and above? Or is it
yes.
Modelings are better?
Yes to the last bit, 100%. Because there's loads of examples of older smoky whiskies that are superb. Phenol compounds die off during maturation, that's actually true. Although there's other phenol compounds that do get added. So the thing about peat is it's not as simple to say that peat is one compound. It's not. So the flavor of peat, the flavor of smoke, is made up of lots of different compounds, mainly phenol compounds, and these compounds all react slightly differently through production and then through maturation. But they do tend to dissipate. So they tend to dissipate through aging, which means that if you do have something that's very, very peaty at the start, over time, it will become less so as a general rule of thumb, or at least the compounds will change, so it will present differently. What I tend to find is that whiskies live on a wave, right? So aging isn't this, and it's not that either. So you don't have a situation that, and a lot of people describe aging like whiskey gets better, it gets better, it gets better, and then it gets worse, it gets worse, it gets worse. That's not what happens. Whiskey goes like this, right? So you'll go through periods where the extraction from the wood is over the top. So you're extracting maybe the first layer of the wood and you end up with it too tannic, too tight. Some people really like that style. They're weird. Don't really understand it personally. Then after you get through that, those compounds that are extracted, they can dissipate and they can fade away or they can change. And so the best example I can give you is you could take a whiskey that's aged in virgin oak, right? So there's lots of examples obviously in America of that, but there's examples in Scotch as well. There's a general understanding in Scotland, they say, oh, you shouldn't use virgin oak for more than 6 months or a year. But I've got a friend who's been doing experiments running it for 13, 14, 15 years. And what you find is that the flavor curve changes dramatically. So yes, you get lots of that kind of tannic, heavy vanilla at the start, but after you get past the kind of 12, 13, 14 year point, that actually dissipates altogether and you get left with flavors like peach, like ripe peach. And that's just the way those compounds are changing with oxygen and with air. Phenols are the same. So phenol compounds will evaporate or change over time. Things will become less peaty, maybe, but they will, more importantly, change and adapt to being something else. So some of my all-time favorite whiskies are whiskies that may have been very smoky when they were younger, but the compounds have changed and made it more fruit-driven or more expressive. The last thing I'd say is it's also almost impossible to judge, because if you take a whiskey like Lefroy, okay, and you said, oh, Lefroy's great when it's 10 years old, when it's young, because it's really peaty. Well, if you try Lefroy 10 right now, it's very ashy. Yeah, it's really phenolic and very ashy. You try Lefroy 10-year-old bottled in 1991, 2, 3, 4, it's really fruit-driven. Yes, it's smoky. Yes, it's phenolic, but it's not ashy. It's more fruit, more tropical. Now, if you took the same whiskey and you age it on for like 25 years, 28 years, you still have all that fruit. Maybe the phenols have changed, but you've now got a beautifully expressive whiskey and it's very delicate. Whereas if you take the current Lefroy and age it for 25 years, it'll taste completely different. You can't take a 25 or 30-year-old whiskey today and say, oh, well, the 10-year-old whiskey today will taste like that. It won't, because distilleries are not run, even though some marketing companies might tell you they are, distilleries are not run consistently over a 30, 40, 50 year period. They're just not. Scotch whiskey is driven by money, right? And I don't mean that in a negative way. It sounds awful, but it's very simple. If you, Chanel, don't cry, it's fine. You think of it this way. If you have the money to run in one particular way and then people stop buying whiskey, as has happened, God forbid it ever happens again, then you change your production to make it cheaper, to make it more affordable, so you can carry on running. Now, some distillers will tell you that we do it in a way that doesn't change the flavor. Bollocks. Definitely changes the flavor. The only thing I disagree with is the idea that it makes it better or worse. It just changes it. So between that and your wood policy, all of these small changes amount to changes in flavor, which are both good and bad, sometimes great, sometimes bad.
Are some things that you can fix in recasking?
Yeah, I wouldn't even say it's recasking. So the example I use quite a lot is if you track wood management in Scotch whiskey. Nowadays, we're very hot on wood management. The whole Scotch whiskey industry will talk about woods in a very proactive way, and probably much better than we were even 10 or 15 years ago. But if you think back to even 15 years ago, they didn't have the same wood policy we have today, right? Nobody cared. It's only because marketing departments turned up and started talking about it, as people really started giving a shit. The forerunners for that, the people who really did care about it, were Willie Grant, with David Stewart, way ahead of his time, and Bill Lumsden. Like, they were way ahead of their time. And I'd say the whiskey industry as a whole is still only catching up in the last 5-6 years. If you look at why whiskies were really good in, say, the 70s, like bottled whiskey is really good in the 70s or the 80s, largely it's because the wood policy is dictated by politics and economics. So during World War II, there was no Scotch whiskey produced, or very little Scotch whiskey produced, which means that all the casks that we're buying in the late 40s, 50s are new, right? So everything you're filling is into new wood, which means during the 60s, everything you're filling is into either new wood or second fill. Now, in an ideal world, this is the wood you would buy. It's really active, it adds a lot of flavor, it's relatively well balanced. So you've now got really good quality wood and you've got really good quality spirit, and you make a great product. And anyone who's tried those whiskies will tell you that whiskey distilled in 64 through to 69 is probably the best spirit you'll ever try in your life. Come the late 70s, the whiskey market's in decline, we've got less money, so we start trying to reuse that wood again. And through the 80s, they're still reusing that wood. By the time you get to the late 80s, and you're trying spirits like some of the late 80s Bernhardt, the late 80s Glenrothes, that's all in third, fourth fill wood. The wood's probably going on to 50 years of age. Now, you think to yourself, oh, well, it's terrible, it's tired. Okay, but the spirit is also quite fruit-driven. And the reason the spirit's fruit-driven is because the distillery was closed for 4 days a week. Fermentation doesn't stop, right? You fill your fermenter and you leave it. And then you come back 4 days later when you open the distillery and you've now got really long ferments. You've got this much more fruit-driven spirit that you filled into very old wood. Now, if you bottle it as a three-year-old in a blend, yes, it's pants. It'll be terrible, right? But if you then leave that for 30 years, like if you try the Glenrothes we've just bottled, it's the best example of this. You've got this beautifully elegant, fruit-driven whiskey, which probably would not have been as elegant if you put it into first fill barrels. It's perfect in refill casks that, I'm really sorry, Chris, they leaked a lot, so you lost a lot of liquid. My point is that all of those factors, they're not thought out. It's not a process that someone has sat down in an office and said, this is how we will make great whiskey. It's reactions to the situation to make the best out of it. And all those things have created all these different flavors. And the great thing about Scotch whiskey is the choice, right? There is no product in the world where you can try this much stuff. And it is created by chance. For me, that's far more magical, it's far more romantic to talk about the fact that we can have all this amazing choice, all this amazing stuff by chance, not by thought out precision. Sorry, I've really riled on that.
Well, because people are interested actually, and it sort of comes into, and I know we're gonna get onto our Portiskeg 18-year-old, but take the example of, say, the Laphroaig 30, would they have planned to give a higher PPM at the start to make sure it goes through longer, or they just choose
those? No, certainly not then, for now. Like, the best example, like, most modern science on cask maturation says that you should, if you want to age your whiskey for longer, you should fill it at a higher strength, because your extraction rate at the start, you'll extract more tannins at the start and more sugars later on. Whereas if you want a younger whiskey, you should fill very low. You should fill like 58%. And then you can bottle at 7, 8, 9 years old and you make a much sweeter, like more palatable whiskey. But even now, companies aren't doing that. They put into cask at 63.5. They do it because they've done it that way forever, and they will continue doing it that way until someone makes a really good case from a financial reason for doing it. The decisions are not made for a product in 30 years' time, because you don't know what the market's going to do in 30 years' time. No one the Scotch whisky industry reacts. When times are good, you think it's going to stay good for a long time. You hope it is. But the reality is you're not planning, oh, well, I'll make this 30-year-old whiskey now. What you do is you make a whole load of whiskey thinking that the market's going to stay good for a period of time. And then you, when it doesn't, you sell it off. And it's why you have periods like now where we've got this gap, right? So the current stock gap, and I don't mean about ours, although ours is the same, is between about 2000 and 2011. Right, so there's a period of about 10 years where production was quite low because the whole Scotch whisky industry had just gone through the 90s where no one really drank, or no one drank whiskey. They were all too busy doing meth and whatever else people did in the 90s. And the end result is they didn't feel they needed to make any whiskey. Now, as it happened, in about 2003, 2004, 2005, the market starts exploding, right? People start buying more and more whiskey. And the Scotch whisky industry doesn't catch up until 2011, where it goes, shit, we've got to make tons. So they make loads of whiskey. Like, everybody's pumping it out. And if you look, that's when all the planning permission went in, or when companies started building like the 10 million litre plants and the 20 million litre plants, suddenly everyone needs a lot of whiskey. Ironically, by 2018, we have a recession and the whole market's gone, oh no, it's not what we thought. So everyone kind of pulled back a bit. But it means that there's now a lump in 2011 to about 2018 of a lot of stock. And there's absolutely nothing from 2001 to 2010. So you end up in this really weird world where we're always reacting to the situation around us. But selling a product that we're telling people we thought of 30 years ago, I'm pretty sure I'm not supposed to say this, but yeah, it's largely utterly bollocks. My favorite ever trip I ever did, for lots of reasons, largely George Grant related, which is in Spain, and then ended in a really, really weird nightclub at 4 a.m. My favorite moment of the whole thing was he did this, he took us there for a launch of, I think it was one of the Fino casts, 1960 Fino or whatever. And we went to see the cooper he uses now, which is a guy called Miguel Martin. I buy a lot of casks from Miguel because he makes great wood, right? Really consistent wood. And they were trying to combine, like the PR department had tried to combine, we're going to take you to a cooperage to see how sherry casks are made while we launch this Fino. And I remember someone asked Miguel, so did you make the cask for this whiskey? And he's like, well, no. I mean, business has not even existed that long. And I looked at George, and George's like, ah, it's all bollocks. I mean, at the end of the day, this is where good wood comes from, so that's where we buy it from, right? We buy the wood from here. But the marketing department wants that they've had this family relationship for 50 years. It doesn't exist. Why would it exist? It's not real. It's just marketing BS. And the thing I love about Scotch whisky is it's full of people like George Grant who will largely just tell you, yeah. And I think it's much more healthy to share with you and say, look, this is what we actually do. This is how it actually works. And yet we make such amazing whiskies. It doesn't need to be, Scottishmen in kilts hanging around stills, speaking to guys in Spain about their bodega they've been making sherry in. I mean, all of that's rubbish. Like, nobody uses casks that have been used in the production of sherry. One, the wood is dead. I mean, we've tried, so I know. The wood is dead, it doesn't have any wood sugars. Two, the casks leak because they're all 70 years old. And three, they very, very rarely close down any Solera systems in Spain. So, and also, no one drinks sherry. So, yeah. Anyway. So, Chanel, I've gone from not doing anything controversial to basically calling out the whole whisky industry. Shall we move on?
I secretly love it. It's fine. I think everyone else does too. But yes, Portiskeg 18, my friend, our last whisky.
So, really happy we're finishing on this. This is, this as a cask is kind of stolen from my boss. Every now and again, like one of the great things about having the keys is that he kind of forgets what we've got, so I get left alone. The history of this cask is quite interesting. Years and years ago, when we started Portiskeg, we had this vision that there would be this infinite lake of whiskey forever and ever and ever. And then about a year or 2 years in, it stopped, right? And suddenly we couldn't buy any Islay whiskey. Luckily, we'd bought mountains and mountains of Kalila. Largely, we've run out of that now, but I'm also now able to buy mountains of Kalila, so life is still good. And just when we were told we couldn't get consistency of liquid anymore, we bottled a 12-year-old. And at the time, what we were doing is we were taking lots of casks that we owned, batching them together and bottling them. And Sikinda would do what I do now, so he would try all the casks on the line and see if there was anything particularly outstanding, and he'd pull it out. So when I do a batch of Portiskeg 100 proof or 8-year-old, when I go to bottling hall, I'll try the 50 casks we're putting into the batch. And if there's anything really good, I pull it out and then I'll bottle it under single malt for Scotland, say. So Sikinda did the same thing with our 12-year-old. And one of the casks he pulled out was the one you're about to try. So he pulled this out when it was 12 and said, this is outstanding, I'll keep it and I'll bottle it as an exclusive for myself later on. I may have promised Chris something on Portiskeg to do with like an 18-ish year old whiskey, thinking at the time, yeah, I'm sure I've got some. And then I looked and found I had one barrel, which was the one that Sikinda was keeping. But luckily, he'd completely forgotten about its existence. So I bottled it instead for the US, for Impex. So this is 18-year-old Kalila, distilled in the year 2000. Yeah, 2000. That originally was moved to the bottling hall to be bottled as 12-year-old. But it was decided it was too damn good, so we kept it and then forgot about it. And now we get to drink it as a single cask. Wonderful thing. you guys probably all know Kalila pretty well as a make. There's loads of it about. Like, Kalila's a 6 million litre distillery plant built in the 70s. It looks like a factory, and it makes a lot of whiskey. But for my money, it's the most consistent quality make you can buy, right? It's the best make to work with. If anyone bottles a bad Kalila, it's very simple. It's their fault. They did it. Kalila as a distillery has done nothing wrong its entire existence. Even the 60 stuff, so before the rebuild, it's pretty intense and pretty amazing. This is kind of classic in terms of Kalila, so it's got that minerality to it. It's got that citrus to it. Very fresh and clean, and it is absolutely my kind of whiskey. This is the kind of thing I would drink every day. I'm very happy because I stole the rest of the tasting bowl, fresh enough, and got sent it yesterday.
I see.
These tastings, by the way.
I know, I haven't had it yet. I'm making do with Portiskeg 28-year-old right now.
So. Flash. I guess in terms of Portiskeg, because I've not really touched on that at all, Portiskeg is a single malt whiskey. It's always from Isla. It doesn't have a distillery name on it because we're an independent bottler, right? So we don't own a distillery. We buy casks of whiskey. That's what we do. Originally, we always used to buy from Kalila for Portiskeg back in 2009 when we launched. But actually, in the end, by 2015, I started bottling Laphroaig under Portiskeg. I bottled Bunahavan under Portiskeg. And the reason for that was partly because I couldn't get stock of Kalila at the time. But also because I kind of changed my thinking on Portiskeg itself. Portiskeg is a ferry port on Islay, for those that have never been. It has a petrol pump. It has a pub. It's a lovely pub, great whiskey selection, it's ours, and don't eat. I love the people very much, but food is not the best. The thing about Portiskeg is it's where you turn up, right? It's where you arrive. So when we were running low on Kalila and I had to look at other distilleries, I started thinking about what do I want it to taste like? What should Portiskeg taste like? And for me, the key word is elegant. Right? It should be elegant. It should be approachable. I mean, it doesn't sound particularly masculine. In fact, I was told this by someone in a marketing meeting the other day. It should be pretty, right? It should be a pretty whiskey. You should drink this and think, wow, that's really attractive. It's really romantic. It makes me warm inside. And what I find is Isla's a funny place. Everyone always talks about peat, right? They always talk about those big phenolic whiskeys. Oh, it's all smoke and blah, blah, blah. The whiskies are pretty. The whiskies are beautiful, right? The Laphroaig is a beautiful whiskey. It's a complex, balanced dram. When you dig into the bones of the Laphroaig and you try certainly the stuff in the early 90s or even up to about 1998, they're beautifully fruity whiskies. And for me, that should be celebrated. Bunahavan, similarly, although it's largely not peated, they do a peated make and it can be very, very pretty, very, very elegant. There are makes on Isla that are obviously a bit more brutal. Ardbeg, I find it to be very peaty, lots of chocolate orange, but it's not pretty, it's just big. That being said, it is also one of my favorite whiskies. So this was bottled 2007. It's brilliant, by the way, if you find them. Big Gold Stripe, buy that. For me, I want to put a skate to be an introduction, but an opening. So where people could come to Isla and understand Isla whiskey is not just big smoky whiskies, it's also beautiful whiskies. And I hope that this single cask fits into that. For me, it does. It's both smoky, but elegant. All right.
Ollie, in terms of how you're managing our casks, so are you, you buy the spirit from a distillery. Sometimes you buy the spirit from a distillery and recask it. And sometimes you just buy the whiskey outright.
We buy everything outright and own it outright in terms of the spirit. And in terms of wood too, we tend not to buy wood. You can with some distillers, you can buy wood and you can rent wood from them. Although I don't do that. The way we manage our stocks is, we basically review all samples when we get them in. We'll then choose if we think it needs recasking, and we buy the wood. So we'll go out into the market. I essentially buy from two cooperages for bourbon barrels, one in the States, Kelvin, where I get really reliable supply. I buy from Space Eye Cooperage because everyone buys a bit from Space Eye Cooperage. But we have a relatively strong, I guess, tough rule on what we purchase. Mainly to do with the way the casks have been treated after they were used for bourbon. So I avoid any casks that were rinsed or basically where anything was extracted from the wood. So I tend to only buy now Buffalo Trace barrels, Wild Turkey barrels. They're pretty reliant, basically. Nothing to do with the bourbon. I should stress that now. It's not so particularly like those bourbons. Good wood. And then for sherry, I buy from Miguel Martin for when I want something really active and where I want something I know what it does. And then I've got a couple of small bodegas I work with who also have cooperages on the side, and we'll buy a little bit from them. They'll fill wood for us, fill it with a sherry and then keep it for 2, 3, 4 years and then sell it on to us. But that's more experimental. We do a little bit of messing around, but not much. I don't tend to do, I'm not a great lover of finishes. So like you will very rarely see anything from us finished in wine or anything else. I've always felt it feels a bit synthetic. So even when it comes to recasking, rarely will we bottle anything that's not been in the cask it's in for less than 2 years, 3 years. Just because of you, that way, at least you get interaction. Does that make sense? Does that answer the question?
Not really sure. I think so, yeah, I think so. I do have a question from Chris here about what you were talking about with the Ardbeg earlier.
Yeah.
What are you talking about with the 2007 Ardbeg 10? Is that back then they were buying?
Okay, so if you look, this has a big gold stripe. You ready, Chris? Okay. There are people who are going to get really upset when I tell you this. And somewhere on the bottom, it's got a lock number there, but you can't really make it out on the camera. And that tells you which year it was bottled. So this is an L7, so it's bottled 2007. Ardbeg was closed for a period of time, which most people know, which means their production was essentially zero. And in 2006, 2007, most of the spirit and 10-year-old is like 17-ish years old. Like it's a lot older. So it's a lot more elegant as a whiskey. It's also a bit bigger. And I find that those particular bottlings are superb, and you can still pick them up for bugger all money because nobody really cares. These are really sad little things that you just become obsessed with.
We bought a bunch of those. L7143s were the ones we were taking down because we thought that was where it was perfect.
Yeah.
It was. We thought it was 17-year-old Ardbeg in those bottles.
Yeah, pretty much. Well, by all maths, it probably is. By all maths, mainly, it probably has some younger stuff in it, but not
and much. I know, Travis, you're in Arizona. I think I took down a couple there. Like, for some reason, there were some old Ardbeg 10s in the liquor stores hanging out. So if you see the old box, you open it up, look for that bottle code, and if you see it, take them. They're great.
Awesome. Well, just look for the gold banner. That's the easiest thing. Because it, like, they changed all the labels. So I actually got one in our bar in the office because it had been sitting there being poured for trade customers like it was normal Ardbeg 10. I walked in and was like, why is it? So I ended up just drinking it. Not much sharing it with people.
Did the same thing happen with the Nevis 10?
So absolutely, about 2 years ago. Do you remember, so when they changed from the tall round recently to the kind of Nika shaped bottle? I don't know if you guys have got that.
No, I didn't.
So they changed from having a tall round to a Nevis shaped bottle. The last two batches of tall round, I know for a fact was 15 plus, because I'm quite good friends with Colin, who obviously retired in the last year, and I had a phone call because he was running out of packaging. He had major issues with pack, and he was speaking to my boss's brother about it, and so I ended up speaking to Colin. I said, how's it going? It's pretty tough. I haven't got any 10-year-olds, so I'm just bottling 17 and being done with it. Brilliant. But those whiskies are beautiful. Nevis 10, I think, is just superb. But Ben Nevis is different anyway, because they're still using, even to this day, they still use brewer's yeast. They are, I mean, if anyone who's ever visited, it's a really odd place. I will say this, it won't mean as much in the States as it does here. It's like going to a 1970s working man's club. So it's got sticky carpets. You know, it's the kind of place you'd expect to have some kind of revolutionary talk with people. And most of the food looks a bit moldy. It's basically not very well run as a visitor center. That sounds awful, but it's a wonderful thing because it basically reflects the distillery that is run like it's in the 70s. And the spirit tastes like that, kind of fat and heavy and fruity. And that makes for great whiskey. You know, the funny thing about Ben Nevis is they run like that and make no bone, like no one talks about it. Springbank runs like that and everyone talks about it being some kind of mecca. Like, well, just buy Ben Nevis. It's largely cheaper and easier to find. So.
Ollie, we've got a question, how you're keeping Portiskeg 8-year-old and 110 consistent.
Not massively well. I think we do a relatively good job. So we work on 50 cask batches. So that's pretty tiny. The example I always give on that is actually Ardbeg. I remember the first time we did a batch of 8-year-old. No, it must be 100 proofs. The first time we ever did 100 proof. It was the biggest batch of whiskey I'd ever worked on. And I was really, frankly, shitting it. I thought it was all going to go horribly wrong. And when it was all finished and we ended up with whatever it was, 25,000 bottles or whatever. I was sitting there going, this is amazing. I will never bottle anything this big in my life. And then I think the week after, like Ardbeg released a special release, limited edition, really low outturn, 70,000 bottles. And I really wanted to cry a little bit. You know, our regular bottling is about a third the size of their limited editions. The plus side of working on such low numbers, so there's kind of 50 cask batches, is that you can taste everything. So Portiskeg 110 contains 7, 8, 9-year-old whiskey, sometimes a bit of 10-year-old whiskey. It depends a little bit on our stocks. So I've got a gap in 2011 where I've got a lot of sherry butts, real shame, but I can't really use them for 110 or 8-year-old. So we had to kind of move the age a little bit up. What we do is we'll move over 50, 60 casks of those vintages to the bottling hall. And then I literally walk down the line and I can do about 50 casks in an hour and a half. It's roughly what I can do without falling over. The reason we do that is very simple. 50 casks is roughly what fits on a wagon. So my family's from Yorkshire. I'm all about saving money if I can. So, you know, one wagon, that's a perfect amount. Then try and fill it, perfect. So we do 50 casks for that reason. And then the other reason is I can taste them about an hour and a half. And it's a lot cheaper, again, back to that kind of Yorkshireman, it's a lot cheaper than ordering the samples. So every time you order a sample of a cask that you own, it costs you between 30 and 80 pounds, right? So if I'm doing a batch of 8-year-old and a batch of 110, that's 100 samples. And suddenly you start talking about quite a bit of money. So what's a lot cheaper is just 100 quid flight to Glasgow and then drinking for a day and then flying back. And that way we can keep a level of consistency. We're lucky because we use Kalila and we use reefer wood, so it's relatively consistent anyway. But what I would say is I'm not Richard Fasten, I'm no David Stewart. I'm not going to claim to be some kind of master blender. I think that term should be held and revered for those guys. What we try and do is bottle good whiskey. So as long as everything that we're putting in there tastes good and fits the profile, we'll bottle. But it's not, I'm not looking, I would always stress this, because we're a small business, because we're a small independent bottler, we're not looking to make the same whiskey every day. We're looking to make something that tastes in a profile, in a set kind of idea, so that when you try it, you'll enjoy it and it'll be what you expect. But I'd also hope that you probably do the same thing that I do on Ardbeg 10. So you can actually find on bottles of Portiskeg, you can find the lot number. It's normally printed on the bottom in really, really tiny writing. And I actually keep those. So I'm sad enough to keep lot 6, 7, 8. I mean, what else am I going to do with the warehouse other than keep random bottles of Portescape 110? Does that answer the question?
Yeah, I think so. I think everyone's in agreement that you need to teach us all how to taste that much whiskey in an hour and a half. we have some questions just about, also back to Single Malts of Scotland tonight, just in terms of what to look out for, certain batches to look out for, certain distilleries that you liked, that you bottled.
So, my favorite distilleries that we've been bottling recently, Imperial, it's superb. It's one of those distilleries that's fast gaining a reputation, but probably needed one long before. Closed in 1998. And it makes a lovely, soft, light kind of vanilla driven. For me, it tastes like vanilla sweets. There's a sweet in the UK called a Chewit. Had this amazing advert with a dinosaur on it. Every time I drink Imperial, I think of this giant green dinosaur. Doesn't really help you, but it really helps me. I look out for all of those. They pretty much all the stock we own, which is from 1989 through to 1998, is all refill, so third fill barrels. Some strengths are quite low, but really beautiful whiskies. Ben Nevis, because I like it. We've got a lot of Ben Nevis. We've been bottling a lot of Ben Nevis 96 and 97. I have some younger stuff that a lot of it we actually bought with new fill. Some of it we bought and recast. So in the kind of next kind of 2-3 years, we'll probably bottle up some kind of 8, 9, 10-year-old Ben Nevis, which is already tasting very good now. Some of the Glen Elgins we bottled, I actually really love. We've had some barrels of Glen Elgin. We also had these really random casks, which I never bottled one recently, 2009. And they say on the paperwork, they say, Hogshead, new wood. I still don't actually know what new wood means. I've yet to find out. On one cask, it turned out to be new wood was a wine cask. On another one, it turned out it was just virgin oak. So it's this like really random cask description that has no real meaning, apart from what it does mean is it's not refilled. Some of those casks have been outstanding, not a little bit random. So yeah, Glen Elgin, really do like Glen Elgin. We do have coming up for the States, as long as Chris likes it. He doesn't know this yet because I've not sent it to him. Bemore 1996, which is just one of my happy places. Bemore in the 90s is generally just a great thing. So they get bought by Suntory in the early 90s, and basically Suntory gut it. They rip out everything. All the stuff that had been put in to modernize it, they took that out. And basically turn back the clock. And they did that because basically Suntory as a business is obsessed with quality, and specifically obsessed with 1960s Vermore, as is anyone who's drunk 1960s Vermore. It's a perfectly understandable thing to become obsessed with. And if you try 93 to, well, frankly, you can try any Vermore, but 93 to 99 is some of the most interesting vintages for that distillery. They were on brewer's yeast. They changed in 99. They tended to be on much higher floor malting quantity because basically the overall yield was down. They were making less whiskey, so they tended to use more of their floor malting, so it had much higher floor malting quantity. But it actually tends to be a little bit more phenolic as well. It tends to be a bit peatier. And every single one we've had has been excellent. So we're bottling a 1996 or more. As well as some other tasty things. I hope that answered.
I think so. Which distilleries do you have direct contract with?
As in filling contracts, or so I work with pretty much everybody, more or less. I think there's a distillery company. I'm trying to think of a distillery company I've not done any business with over the years. I've pretty much done business with everybody, more or less. Maybe some of the smaller guys. In terms of filling contract, we fill with I think it's what, a dozen, maybe slightly more malt. I wouldn't go into all of them. I fill some Diageo malts, fill some smaller independent distilleries as well. So pretty much we deal with everybody. I'm also buying, like, I'll buy a lot from blenders. So where you've got blending companies who don't own a distillery as such, but they are blending companies, not brokers. So where their blends aren't doing so well, I'll come buy up their bulk, 3 or 4 or 5 year old, if it's good mates.
I think that's it from me.
Yeah. I'm going to drink something else. Have you all got more whiskey to drink?
Guys, bring in the questions then. I'll get something.
Brilliant. Okay. I'm going to move on to this. Just because I've been talking about Lafroy all evening. So if I don't drink Lafroy, I'm going to go absolutely mental.
I've got my mort
left. I was going to drink Belgian beer while I talked to you, but then drank them before we started.
Everyone is now permitted to go get their Lafroy.
Yeah. Or their Kilhoman.
Yeah, you could get Kilhoman. So Kilhoman is one of those distilleries where we have actually bottled. We were the first company to bottle an independent bottling of Kilhoman before Anthony Wills phoned up and said, never again, never, never, never again. Which I believe stayed the same until he met Joshua. And Anthony is actually a very, very good friend of mine, as a son. Mainly because he used to be a filthy broker. He doesn't tell anyone that. But I've got records. He gives me all this rubbish about being a barnacle on the bottom of the distiller's boats and whatnot. All that being said, he makes superb whiskey. Kilhoman is probably my favourite newer distillery.
Ollie, that's really well done. I know everyone in LA Scotch Club or OC Scotch Club or all the Scotch clubs, they love to get into all the details, and it's nice, even though you're worried about the middle of the road, everyone wants the dirty details. So it's thank you for sharing those.
Andy, no, if you could just not record it or repeat it, it'd be fine. Well, the one on YouTube.
I should know about that because she's recorded this whole thing.
You didn't tell me that.
We'll bleep anything out. We have to.
Will actually come to me. What's it worth to you to get rid of this evidence?
Oh, my friend,
Elijah,
this is mild.
Bringing everyone together. Thank you both.
You're welcome.
Oh, thank you very much for having us.
Yeah, Ollie, absolutely.
I got a question for you, Ollie. You mentioned that you got a lot of the Glenburgie. You obviously have. Brought to the States. Last year you had a bottling a barrel in the UK. Was that from the same lot?
Yeah. So it was one big parcel. We've got some younger Glenburgie as well, which was completely different when we bought somewhere else. So this is one-off purchase. I've done a bit of dealings with the distiller slash blender a few times. And it basically comes down to the fact that a lot of these makes, because they're big workhorse distilleries, like it's a Chivas malt, and it essentially goes into Ballantine, right? But they'll sell it to other people for their blends, or they'll swap it with other people for their blends, right? What happened in this particular case was that a marketing department or someone decided, and I only know this because the head of bulk for this company phoned me up and told me. They basically ended an age statement whiskey. So they had an age statement blend that used to use this in. I think it was a 12-year-old. They discontinued that. They told him they were discontinuing that. And so because of that, he had, I think I bought two different makes from him that would have gone into that blend, which he had, which were quite old. And I was looking for that kind of stock. And it was just luck. We happened to be having a conversation at that time. And he asked me if we would take it, which obviously we did. Very, very nice. Ironically, the guy phoned me up about a month later and said, oh, the marketing department's actually changed their mind and they do really want us to have an age statement on our blend. Is there any chance I could get the stock back?
Good job. I mean, there's a beautiful whiskey. Thank you.
Yeah, it's a lovely whiskey. I mean, a lot of it is, like Michael, a lot of it's chance. Like, I'm not... What we're good at, what I feel we're good at, again, I'm not good at figuring this up, is we're drinkers, right? So I come from a background of working in shops and drinking too much. In fact, the only reason I got a job in the shop was it paid for me to drink whiskey and obviously made it free, which was incredibly good. I don't claim that we're the best at anything apart from the fact that we love whiskey and we like sharing it. So I think that any independent bottler's job is essentially to be lucky and then to share that luck around a bit. And make it right.
That means I'm going to be lucky because you're going to have a few more releases of Glenburgie then, right?
We'll try and do a few. Yeah, no
problem. Excellent.
We've got quite a few people excited for tomorrow and a few people a little miffed that they're not coming tomorrow. We might have to do a second day too, Ollie. Have to talk to these guys and see what they
think. A second day.
A second day.
I just want to say thank you to everyone that showed up. There's a lot of just cool of seeing everyone's faces. Ollie especially, I know you're being very humble. And I know from all these releases that I've gotten to try and some UK releases I've had, they're all great. I know everyone had a good time here, as I could see from the comments. So yeah, I just want to say thank you to the Elixir team, to Chanel to help moderating today, and even for Mitch coming in and doing his little black top spiel there. That was awesome. And yeah, to the Impex team, I know Sam is on here, and Dan, Chris, all you guys, thank you, Brian. Thanks so much for showing up. I'm gonna post it one more time. The mixing glass is doing 10% off using the Scotch Club code. If you buy 4 bottles, there's a $10 flat rate shipping. And I'm pretty sure they can ship to all the states you guys are in. And they do free in-store pickup and curbside pickup as well. So yeah, if you're local. So I appreciate all you guys. This is a lot of fun. It's a good turnout. And thank you, Andy, also for coordinating everything and doing helping me out with this and getting all the connections here.
I know we do have some stinky states that might not help you out some of you states, I know Georgia's sometimes a problem. If they won't deliver to you directly, you have a friend in the club, just talk to me and we'll get those to you somehow.
My people are always the problem, aren't they?
You talking about the redheads?
The no, Georgia native. The North Georgia native right there.
Some of the whiskeys are in Florida if you want to jump across. That's the only thing I can
think of. So guys, I don't have control of this one, and usually I do a poll. What was, just for funsies, what was the favorite of the night? And in lieu of doing a formal poll, we're just going to stick our hands up for, and I'll skip the rum. That's just, it's just not because it's bad. It's just not a scotch, and it can't compare. So the ones we had tonight, just doing a quick look. Raise your hands if Linkwood was your favorite. Is that just, there's not many Linkwooders. I thought it was pretty damn good though. All right, raise your hands if, what was the next one? Glenburgie was your favorite. I'll raise my hand on that one.
We got triple hands in one window.
Yeah, okay. Glenburgie was definitely popular. And what was the third? The Ardmore. Raise your hand if Ardmore was your favorite tonight. Pretty even, I think, with Glenburgie and Port Eskaig. Well, it's hard to see exactly, but I think it was a three-way tie. No offense to Linkwood, it was really good.
I think you need to do a poll, Andy.
I can't. I don't have the host.
Yeah, then didn't have Chanel do it.
No.
That's hard for her to do, like, on the fly.
Hold on, I can.
I usually set him up ahead of time.
Oh, do
but,
you?
But, yeah, it's... If you can do it, I can talk while you try to figure it out. I'm pretty good at stalling for time.
been doing sort of open discussion now, Andy, or are we?
I think so. I think one thing we'll do right now is, in the event that some of the UK guys have to leave, let's just give them Oliver especially, a big thank you.
Thank you, Oliver.
I don't know if this discussion will stay on this chat room. I don't know if they want to keep it open. If they don't want to keep it open and have to close it, I can open the Scotch Club chat room. I'll see that in a bit. But you guys are welcome to continue on chatting. I know for some of us in the West Coast, we might try to get something done today.
Right.
I'm sure in Atlanta, you're probably reeling to go, and this is the perfect time for you. And if you're in the UK, this is probably snooze time. I'm sorry. Thank you for staying up so late with us. With that said, I will let someone else do the chatting. Chanel, do you have something to say?
No, I said it all. It's nice cool. to see you guys. It's been a while since Robbie Burns.
Yeah. So for those who, especially the LA people who sort of remember scratching their head, I think I noticed her, recognize her. She was with Boutique, and now she has landed at a new wonderful job. Oh, yes.
It would be that easy. But it's nice to see y'all.
And
yeah, did you want to make the official announcement, Chanel? I thought you were holding off until today, right?
What official announcement, mate?
Just where, you know, that you're living in London and working for Elixir now. Yeah. Everyone else, you were still in New Zealand.
I'm waiting for a visa. I'm waiting for a visa, but right now, yeah, I'm working with Elixir now. So, but yeah, out of London, that's good.
Oliver,
thank you guys from Connecticut. Thank you.
So before everyone leaves, I'll be posting, you know, just if you follow us on Scotch Club, on any of the Facebook pages, Scotch Club, we have a general one for people from Connecticut that don't have an actual Scotch Club in Connecticut. You can look there if you ever have any questions, and Chanel will remember this from a poem I might have given at a Burns supper recently. Just check the site. If there's an event and it's for sale, it's gonna be on the Scotch Club site, scotchclub.com. Just look at, you'll see some of them will have the cities, some of them will just say cyberspace. Yeah. That's this.
Do you just read your poem from Burns night for everyone who missed it?
No. I don't know who's here.
Come on, you can do it.
This is being recorded.
That's the point.
Oliver, did you want to? Are you still here?
He's asleep.
Okay.
No, I'm happily on my way.
If you want to give a formal goodbye, if you are leaving, this is the time to do it.
All right, so yeah, I am, because my wife will eventually come downstairs and kill me, and no one needs to see that. None of you. I mean,
yes, we do.
Enough violence in the world. Thank you all for putting up with me talking at you. I'm still kind of getting used to this whole talking at lots of faces all at once. I'm naturally a recluse, so this is like you're all coming to my house. It's a bit dragging. That being said, if you're ever in London, I love saying this right now because it's unlikely. If you're ever in London, come down to the office and have some drams. We have free bar. So, you know, definitely worth it. The area is a bit stabby, but don't worry about that. You just have to run fast. Anyway, thank you very much for putting up with me, and hopefully I'll see some of you tomorrow night and see the rest of you at some point in the future.
Thank you, guys. I'm out.
Come on, guys. I'll do some music every once.
Thank you.
Thank you
Ollie.
So much.
Thanks. Thank you. Cheers.
Thank you, everyone.
Cheers.